Matteo Villani, I'm from Italy and I'm a PhD student working in Universitat Autònoma de Barcelona in Barcelona, Spain. I will talk to you about the challenges and the perspective of future telecom technology for the Terahertz world. In this presentation, I will talk to you about who we are, why are we working on Terahertz domain, and what is the technology that we work on, and how I am contributing to this network. So the TeraApps project is a Marie Curie project financed by the European Community. Marie Curie is a group of thousands of projects which at European level finance more than 100,000 research grants. One of these projects is the TeraApps project, who financed my PhD work, which comprises of 10 universities, 10 companies and 15 PhD students, in the world network located in more than 15 countries around the world. My studies started in Polytechnic of Turin in Italy, where I did my bachelor and master studies, while my final project was done in Grenoble, Fermat, in France. And now I work in Universitat Autonoma de Barcelona in Spain with Professor Xavier Orioles, which is my PhD supervisor. So the spectrum of light comprises of many domains. For humans technology, there are two main things that we can make with light. One is used for telecommunication. This is usually a domain with large wavelength, so the signal can travel further. And the other thing that we can make with light is photonics, which brings us LEDs, LEDs, lasers, and optical fibers. It just so happens that there is a space between these two technologies called the Terahertz gap, which is currently not used by any conventional technology. This frequency domain, for its peculiar characteristics, can bring to many applications like imaging for astronomy, for product and food safety, for security, and for biotech. And all these applications are possible even for bulky technologies. But the next possible one is 6G. 6G is an application for faster telecom, and is one of the main drivers of exploration of the Terahertz gap, also because of its need to miniaturization for application of portable devices. I will just focus on this application very fast, because to simulate your curiosity, I would like to explain what would be in principle possible using 6G. So some years ago, we used 3G for telecommunication, letting us have the on-demand videos and video calls. Later on, 6G opened up the world of streaming platform movies that can be downloaded while you watch them, basically. And this is almost all you can do using your laptop, because you have one or two screens and some audio hardware. At 5G will open new horizons for autonomous driving, real cloud computing, and the Internet of Things. This could be more data than any human could possibly see in a lifetime. And finally, 6G, thanks to being theoretically 100 times faster than 5G, can open possibilities that we cannot even imagine. Okay, because complex system could be described and transmitted through the internet, like example, all the characteristics about a human body. So in some years, we could pass from using the internet to watch low quality cut videos, to using the internet to transmit some information about the whole human being across the planet. If we take a semi-metal element, a metal, and with a lot of hard work from many PhD students through the years, we came up with a technique to build what we call the resonant tunneling diode. I will not talk about the physics, but just know that these devices are extremely small and on the order of a thousandth of the width of a human hair. This let them be and use quantum, live in a quantum regime. After we fabricate an RT device, in fact, if we take a circuit, the RT device itself, and we plug in it in an antenna, it's possible to generate an electromagnetic field which premises well into a Terahertz gap. This would enable 6G technology. So this is all nice, but there is still a problem of how to optimize and engineer this. The RT device can be fabricated, but since I'm an aspiring physician, I would like to understand what it is really doing at Terahertz frequencies. The problem is that the two technologies that I was talking before, telecommunication and photonics, use widely different explanation of how the light behaves. Telecommunication uses sees light as a wave. It gives an explanation in terms of electromagnetics, which is a branch of classical physics. The other one sees the light as made out of particles, which is a quantum idea. As a consequence of this conceptual contrast, there are even further differences on how these two technologies are engineered. While telecommunication mainly looks into how to engineer the antenna and what is the light doing after it left the antenna, in photonics, almost only the electron device itself, so before the antenna, the source is important. Again, in photonics, if the light after it leaves the device is not anymore interesting for the mathematical background of this technology. So some good intuition could link these two worlds, but the mathematical rules are still not very clear and still evolving to this day. So this is one of my roles. We would like to use quantum phenomena to look into the device, then to extend this description to a classical analysis of what is emitted, the electromagnetic field emitted by this quantum system. To do so, some strange rules are needed and some may redefine how we think about electrons. How we contribute more specifically, here on the left you can see a simulation, a schematic of a simulation of a quantum plus classic system. You can see on the RTD, on the box with written RTD, we generate an independent quantum system which interacts with an electron circuit. So the quantum side is the RTD, and the circuit around it is the classical. It's a classical circuit. So it can be interesting to observe what are the two systems doing to each other. A second topic I work on, and it's a bit of introduction. It is known that the current is a device in a device is driven by moving particles. However, the majority of the current is not made out of electrons moving from one side to the other of the device, but is made of the electromagnetic field produced by these particles while they travel. This second phenomena is the one that I show here in Nicole E electromagnetic field, is the blue square rectangle. And this second phenomena is called displacement current. It is irrelevant for long measurement times. However, in the Terahertz domain, with fast measurement, these components become very important, more and more important as we increase the frequency. So what I'm trying to do is adding this component inside some well-known and established models to try to extend them to higher frequencies. Now, I would just to conclude, I would just like to add to you that you should go on and watch the videos of my other colleagues to get a better insight of many stories that I just told you. So, some examples are Michele Cito. He's an Italian engineer. He's working in University of Glasgow in Scotland, and he will explain fabrication of nano devices and a bit better what is a quantum tunneling. Then there is Robin Smith, for example. He is from France. He works in Belgium for K-Site Technology, which is a company that produces equipment for Terahertz measurements. Then there is Anastasia Kudashova. She's from Russia, but she's currently working in Montpellier in France on the use of Terahertz imaging for biotech. And then there are Simone Crocchiati and Meng Zhang. They are working in Duisburg to try to put together this RTD technology and the antenna to make viable the 6G technology. And there are much more. So I really invite you to get curious and look for them. And so I hope I transmitted some curiosity about our work and about the future of telecom. And Matteo Villani, this was an introduction on it.